I guess we need a roll call.
Yes. Chair Mayne.
Here.
Vice Chair Harney.
President.
Director Gibbons. Director Sinks.
Here.
And I'll note that Director Abby Koga is absent today.
By plan. By prior notice, right?
Yes.
Okay. What's next on our agenda that disappeared? Oh, I guess I should have noticed Andrea's back. I didn't register that yesterday when you were there. Consent calendar, approved minutes from the last executive committee meeting. Any questions on that? I'm looking for a motion to approve.
So moved.
Sorry.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? None. Okay, passes unanimously. Regular calendar, so let's go to update on joint request for RFO between Silicon Valley and Monterey Bay.
How exciting is this, anyway? That is not exciting.
It should be exciting.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield to Dennis to kind of give you an overview of what so far has come back, about 90 offers, and a lot of good market intelligence.
Please.
So just to give you an update, I'll kind of run through the timeline. On September 15th is when we issued our RFO to the marketplace, and then we held a bidders webinar on September 28th, had about 90 people who attended. So it was a good turnout, where we walked through kind of what we're looking for and took some questions as well. The deadline was October 13th. Whereby we received 87 unique offers from 30 developers for 50 different facilities.
Wow.
So we all feel that it was a very good turnout. A few other statistics. Of those 87 offers, 59 were offering storage in addition to the solar projects. And then we had about 17 wind projects. We had a few projects with wind plus solar as well, so right now we're pretty close to finalizing our shortlist, so we'll be announcing that later. We've narrowed it down to about three or four projects where we're going to have a mix of a couple wind projects, a couple solar plus storage projects. The storage that we're looking at is for the two projects we really like are going to be 40 and 45 megawatts, which are large storage facilities. So that's very exciting for us to work through structuring the deal to take delivery of the solar plus the storage. And so we're hoping to finalize that list and notify the all the participants by the end of this week or early next week.
And the solar comes with programming that allows you to store it all during the day and then unload in the evening versus smoothing out peaks?
Well, so we'll be working through with the developer of the project on how we would be scheduling that. And, we as the buyer, it's going to be a joint sharing of the output of the project between Silicon Valley and Monterey Bay Community Power. But we would be optimizing the storage facility, whether it's for shifting during the peak hours when prices are getting depressed and bringing it back out during the evening hours during the ramp, or we might use it for frequency regulation. We'll be monitoring that on a day by day, week by week basis during the delivery period to maximize the value of that storage facility.
So frequency regulation is not our responsibility. Do we get paid for doing that?
Yeah, we can earn revenues through the marketplace by offering in spinning reserves or non-spin reserves and get paid for offering it. And then if it gets taken, we get an energy payment as well.
And do we get a higher RA value with storage with the solar?
Well, so
or that's not been
it's not been finalized yet. We kind of anticipate that you will get more value because solar by itself has pretty low RA value to begin with because they changed the rules from 2018 forward whereby they give the value based on the most needed hours, which solar is ramping down during those periods, so the RA value is a little bit diminished. But with the storage, we anticipate to get the full value of that storage capacity.
Other questions? Okay.
Well done.
Just the stats again. 87 responded.
87 unique offers from 30 developers and for 50 different projects.
Were any of the projects underway already, or is this almost a proposal to buy ground and start?
Well, they're in various stages. Some okay. haven't really started the process. Others actually have filed for an interconnection with the transmission owner, and they've gone through a couple various stages of studies. Usually there's a system impact study that is conducted with the CAISO to see if they're going to have to upgrade the transmission capacity. So various ones are various stages, and we did what was called a project viability scoring, where we gave more weight to those who are farther along in the process than those who haven't started, to help us kind of quantify the value of the projects.
Okay.
And I think Dennis mentioned it, but we'll have the short list as far as NOIs of that list. The next scope is like next week. We'll bring this back to the board.
Okay. Anything else on this agenda item then? So this, there's no action here, I assume. It's just information?
More of an update.
Okay. Go ahead.
Given the our interest in showing regulators that the legislator that we're being responsible, we have plans, for example, to put out a kind of press release on with this information, or have we, or
that this is going to be? We haven't. I've got some good news.
I think we would do it at the point of executing the actual power purchase agreement. We would do a joint release with the developers, because to me we definitely want to promote this, because these projects would be, I believe, the storage facilities would be probably the largest in North America to be contracted for and built.
So how long is it going to take for us to make this?
We're targeting end of December, early January.
Oh, you are?
Yes.
So, you know, from thinking about meetings I have scheduled with the likes of Jim Bell and all, I would love to give him a one-pager sort of summarizing where we are. So if you think it's not worthy of a press release, maybe, maybe not, but I would love... I actually think it would be okay to do something now and something later. Here's the tremendous response we got. I'd think about that. And if in your judgment, right, your professional judgment, no, we want to wait till we've awarded, I would still love to have, I would love to go around and talk to state legislators about this thing that you've done. Okay.
I mean,
Because this is the off season, and I think come January, right, they go back to Sacramento, they're completely consumed. Now is a great time to get to them without a specific ask to say, you know, here's what's coming.
I
would love to go to Jerry Hill.
It'd be great.
I would love to go to, you know, Berman and say, look at this thing we're doing here and the tremendous options that we're having. I've become convinced, talking to a number of people, that we can have to use every means to continue to sell what we're doing. And I mean the whole CCA movement.
Yeah.
I think we just got to keep pounding it home.
I think as soon as we notify all the participants, so we're going to notify the shortlisted folks probably at the end of this week or early next, and then let everyone else know they weren't selected, and then... To me, that would be the time to maybe issue a notice, a market notice about.
From my perspective, if you're going to do one in December, January, I'd do the first one sooner than. I mean, just the fact that you did this RFO and you got 87 responses from 30 developers for 50 projects, you know, and at least you deem them to be feasible. There's some of them are
aren't really interested in that from a business perspective. So you think we're going to actually do this deal?
Yeah.
I just have to say, I really take advantage of our time.
We've communicated that in a couple of times. Yeah. This would be actually something big that we're not.
So how many of the projects are in state and how many are out?
I don't have the exact numbers, but I would say that the majority were in state. One of the ones we are interested in is a New Mexico wind project that we're still kind of having some discussions internally, because there's some for the out of state bringing it in, you may not get the full RA value. There's some risk in it, but we're kind of evaluating that one still. But the other projects, one of the wind projects is in Alameda County, so it's very local, and that one is a very attractive offer that we're definitely going to go with. And the other solar projects we're interested in are in Kern and Kings County. Most of the other projects that were more, there were smaller projects that were a lot more expensive, we're considering all throughout the state, really. I would say I could figure out what was out of state. I have all that data. I don't know, but it wasn't the majority were out of state.
So, follow on that point. We have had people from the unions in California coming and presenting to the board, and remember, we're all elected officials, and that is an important consideration.
Yeah, we usually have in the power purchase agreement some. Requirements for the labor that they utilize during the construction phase to promote that.
And the evaluation process, we did put an extra weight in there.
See, that I think is good information for us to have.
Okay. Should we move on to the next agenda item?
If you do any footprinting, wrapping it as, framing it as a giant project by comparison with other things would be also really welcome. I mean, this idea that we're really, this is not a token thing, this is a big thing, would be huge.
So after the selection process, let's get back to you on that.
Okay, so let's move on to item number 3. Customer Program Advisory Group Charter.
I'll yield to Pam.
Yes, hello. Pamela Leonard. We were given some direction at the last board meeting to come back with a proposed charter to help refine and guide the Customer Program Advisory Group, which we're currently recruiting for. Just a quick update on the recruitment process. There's about 10 days left until applications are due. We've received 13 applications thus far. This is the next item. So fine, we can leave it up. We've received about 13 applications so far from 6 of our 12 member communities. If you are continuing to invite applicants to apply, please feel free to do so. And I'm continuing to work with your city's and town staff to get the word out about it. But the proposed charter that we came up with, from what we understand and all the discussions we've had about this, is that the group is chartered to serve as a conduit for community input and review of prospective residential customer programs, since these are residential customers, to prioritize and recommend candidate programs through quantitative and qualitative analysis. These are the measurement criteria and metrics that we've been working with our member agency working group on, and we presented on these earlier, and we're continuing to kind of refine those and have some metrics associated with the programs that we're evaluating. And then the final part of the charter is that the CPAG members will communicate and promote the board adopted programs. So there'd be some time, a few months after we gave this deadline of, no later than June, having a list of, candidate programs or priorities that the residential customers would like, and then there'd be a few months to have them sort of maybe help with some implementation ideas around the, or some design ideas on how we do some of these programs. So any feedback or questions? Yeah.
So I think one of the things that was talked about quite a bit, and I think ended up quite clear, that this group may not come up with programs that have high qualitative impact, but that was going to be okay. So I want to be careful about doing prioritizing and recommending candidate programs through quantitative and qualitative analysis. I'm not sure how else to consider candidate programs through qualitative and quantitative analysis, and then prioritize and recommend. Somewhere in here, I thought there might be some language that talks about community, that biggest bang, not the biggest bang in the bucket, that's not what I'm trying to say, the community engagement, where really this small short-term group is there for community engagement. These are people who are coming up with things that grassroots, day-to-day people really want. You know, it might not make a huge difference. It might not be a thing. And my favorite thing, of course, is the gas windblowers. There's the gas lawnmowers. There's electric water heaters. There's electric washing machines. I mean, these are not big picture things, but maybe I'm looking for the word emotional engagement. So how would we put that into this?
So that's kind of where we threw in the qualitative analysis part. So the quantitative part, like, we're working on with, you know, metrics where we can have those measurements that we've been asked to provide with, you know, metric tons of CO2 offset for, like, how many, you know, dollars per metric ton, right? So that's the quantitative part. But that added value that you're talking about, exactly, that qualitative, well, you know, so you have all these numbers, right? You have, you know, what's sort of the benchmark of this cost for this many metric tons? This is what we need. I mean, if you all would like to give very specific categories and like, no, we want the most bang for our buck, if that's not it, you want community engagement program, you want, and then maybe another one that has a bigger CO2 reduction impact, you know, there's more, you know, things that. So I'm trying to.
I know,
yeah.
And I am too.
Yeah. So,
I am too.
Yeah.
I think as a board do want to have the qualitative analysis information.
Yeah. So that.
But I'm going to say, perhaps it's a secondary, not in the same line. It's a secondary thing. Prioritize and recommend candidate programs of significance to the residential community.
Yeah, that's pretty much selling out what Pam was emphasizing in the qualitative. So in the,
I know, but it doesn't say that.
Yeah. So in the quantitative, we're thinking of metrics like reducing GHG, cost to society.
Forgive me, I really honestly get all of that.
Yeah.
But it's not what that says.
Yeah. So
and it's not going to help us.
Sure.
Connect with the people that are on the panel. So they may or may not care about the qualitative analysis. Look how much we have to go through to understand what qualitative analysis is. I'm not thinking that we want to spend a lot of time educating people about that. It's part of things that will grow and learn, but at least I'm speaking for myself, but I think this is related to the conversation at the board level. What is it that this group is wanting? What does the group want to do? Perhaps more than what we want it to do? I'm just trying to toss
I think this is part of the challenge of we kind of need to maybe frame and perhaps give both of those options, because we don't know yet what the group is going to want, because perhaps the folks selected, based on the interesting applications I've seen so far, we may have some folks who are going to be really gung-ho about, we need to reduce CO2 to the max that we can. We might end up with a group that really only cares about that. So unless we...
I'm hoping not.
Yeah, so again, we've had 13 applications. And
yeah, I know. And I'm not trying to be naive about it.
No,
the board was struggling that we didn't want professional energy people.
Yeah.
Because
well,
we got quite a few.
You're appointing them. So
yeah.
I know.
But
and what happens is they're going to be some.
There's
going to
be a
mix,
ideally.
So,
looking at others.
One question I have for the charter, perhaps what we can do and write it into the charter is provide us a list of community engagement programs and provide us a list of your priorities for high impact, you know, to our mission, carbon reduction programs. I mean, that is, like, could we be really specific in your direction as a board to this group as, like, this is what we would like? You know, perhaps it's, yeah, a community engagement program,
and you
a transportation
can,
program.
And then the board, the group can prioritize amongst themselves which is more important to them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's getting closer. I like the idea of there being a separation between the qualitative and the quantitative. I think that that's really important. I did not do it all in one sentence.
Okay.
This is me speaking, not everybody.
So I think that the purpose of this group is to help us choose programs that people, the users, will get excited about and participate in. You know, it's good to have, you know, those people that are gung-ho that want to reduce carbon, but we need, what we're trying to do is get the voice of the masses and find out what will get them involved.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what we're... That's what you're saying by qualitative, but it's not very clear that's what we're trying to do.
Spell that out. Okay. So that is pretty clear then that we are looking for that qualitative, like community engagement, what our neighborhood wants. But yeah, so fair warning though that the a lot of the applicants right now there's a lot of PhDs. So. You know,
they buy energy too.
They do, and no, I mean, and to your point,
and
you know, you are looking. You know, we had that debate earlier, right? Of we are looking for folks who really know this stuff, but we also are looking for the folks who really just want to. What's going to help my community? What's going to be used in my neighborhood?
I mean, I'm still looking at it from the original presentation, which was we need people to get excited about Silicon Valley Clean Energy. We need them to be engaged and excited. And forgive me, sometimes PhDs are a little dense.
I don't have a PhD. I have a master's degree in science.
Anyway,
the question is whether they, you know, PhDs.
I'm just being silly.
Take in, I mean, maybe your concern is like, well, okay, can these people who are so, who like to quantify everything, right? Can they see and help us discover the trends in the programs that would actually get good uptake, right? So the professional marketing word is uptake. You're going to put a lot of money on the table. The embarrassing thing for the board at the end of the year is going to be come back and there's a bunch of, there's a bunch of money on the table. We spent a bunch of money on marketing, so there were hard costs associated with our ability to do this. And because we had a consumer advisor, program advisory group that, or personally a couple of them got all excited, right? We did that thing, but it turns out that, you know, the subset of, so again, speaking as the nerd, all right, subset of people who actually share their point of view is limited enough. Yes, you happen to pick a couple of people that got on this panel because they just want to put solar on their roof. And it doesn't matter to them what else you tell them about who else is interested. They just like go for the thing that is a particular appeal to them in their particular circumstance. And may or may not be widely applicable, right? But
right.
So the quants
it's
in the room, putting their other hat on, will say, okay, what's the uptake? And right, what's the probability that this money can be absorbed? And well, how effective is it, right? So you could pour a lot of money down a rat hole
offsetting a purchase that somebody might otherwise already make, and find that it, you know, compared to other measures you could take to reduce carbon, that it's not, you know, it has marginal benefit, right?
So part of the process, is actually educating that.
Yeah, right.
As
so,
well.
Right.
So we've got to spend
gotta
some
bring
time.
Them along and spend some real time helping them understand. Because they may come with no background in any place, right?
Yeah.
So you have to kind of
and
talk
we
to them.
We are in the process of receiving a couple proposals from facilitators, right? So we are looking for someone who really knows how to move a group of, like, really diverse experiences and backgrounds and interests, helping them move along swiftly, because we don't want this to be, you know, 10 meetings later, we're still educating everybody on, you know, we want to really move this along, and so they can hopefully kind of help bring the group to a consensus if they are on very different, you know, levels of understanding and interests, and then we can utilize other tools in terms of, you know, how market viability is on these things with focus groups and surveys, like additional tools to test those things.
Like if they come all wanting, to ban lowers, we would educate them that that's not possible. I'm just kidding. But so they would need to be educated on the market forces, on the viability of things, on how, on our business, why should we do this actually, that would be related to our business,
and
the mission of SBCD.
So I would just offer that sometimes we have to be careful that we don't over-educate or spend too much time up front of educating, you know.
You're looking for the more of an unvarnished opinion of people.
Yeah,
that.
That's a good phrase.
So I think this is where it's looking and thinking about how we're going to try to move this along in a quick way is, at least as we've been already for months now spending so much time on developing these measurement criteria so that we have those metrics in place, if they at least understand the methodology, not like we're asking you to calculate what the carbon savings are, but just, hey, everyone, this is the methodology.
Here's
so if you're
one
coming,
of many inputs you ought to consider.
Right, as you're coming to the table with a million ideas that you think are going to be great, like, here's kind of how you can evaluate the weight of these things.
So I guess I'm trying to say is I think staff and your facilitator will perhaps need to be more flexible, that the group may not be as trainable as you might think. So just, you know, you're going to have to feel your way, like we're all feeling our way in all of these issues. Just going to do what you're going to do.
Throw out a different question on this. Thinking of the put finance constraints on this, but you've got $5 million program budget. This is a residential group only. The residential only makes up a third of energy sales.
Yep.
Do we want to put a parameter that they've got a third of the $5 million to play with?
We talked about that earlier on.
Yes, I think.
Go ahead and remind me. I remember the discussion, but I'm not sure of the particulars.
I don't remember either.
I think the question was if we have planning a commercial, and we are. It's not part of this group. We check the commercial customers through workshops, through one-on-one, groups, where we can meet their need and create some programs that are in the commercial. But for residential programs, and maybe we can allocate a couple millions or 1.5 or 2 million.
Separate from this $5 million.
No, it's within the $5 million.
All right,
that's to
John's point.
Yeah.
So that's probably
so of the $5 million. How much do we want to devote to
this
residential?
How much do we want to do with? Well, you have to probably come up with a recommendation that we start with a percentage based on the energy use, and you can change it depending on what comes out of the commercial end.
Okay.
I mean,
we could
elect
as a board, we could say, okay, well,
you can, yeah.
This is kind of like, the Constitution, how Congress was formed. You have something strictly based on proportion. Like the House of Representatives, so based on load, and then you have, you maybe say, well, okay, we're going to have a little more weighting based on number of customers, which would cause you maybe to take what's a third and make it a half or something.
Mm-hmm.
And on the other, I mean, so that sounds appealing to me on the one hand, doing something like that, but on the other hand, right, I'm not, if the problem. Take that back, recording. if we've seen that, you know, our opt-out rate is really low among residential customers, and the real problem we're having business-wise is keeping commercial customers, then maybe I don't want to do anything. I mean, I want to use program funding to incent retention of CNI customers. Or maybe you, after thinking about it, you look at what's possible, you meet with them, and you say, okay, here are the things they're interested in doing. But the amount of money we're putting in the bucket isn't significant enough to change their mind anyway. So I don't know, but I mean, that's kind of just
so
behind my eyeballs what's going on in my head about this.
Right, so how about a variation on a theme? We pick a number. Out of the 5 million, we pick 4 million, and out of the 4 million, we do 1/3, 2/3, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. Then there's a million left over.
Left for the best ideas.
Left for the best ideas.
That's a cool one. I like that.
Oh.
That's good. That's kind of cool.
It gives a lot of flexibility.
You have to realize that the spending within the residential community, you cannot really spend enough to fulfill everybody's needs. However, it goes a long way in creating brand and goodwill.
Yeah, I keep forgetting to use your phrase, creating brand. We need to create brand.
it takes time and effort to prepare, but it can be done.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, I was up at...
You know, so if we could go to the brand thing, that's what I've been trying to figure out. Is our goal to reduce greenhouse gases as much as possible, or we're now saying part of our goal is to build a brand? But I remember the board throwing up all over the idea of the Nest thermostats, which was your quick win on branding. So I'm struggling with what the board really wants.
Well, they threw out we all loved the Nest thing, but it was a complexity of PG&E and their programs and different things. I'd have gone
there's
for it in
too,
a minute.
Right. I think there's still support on the board for branding.
Absolutely.
It's just, yes, there were questions about whether there was conflicting or something going on there. And,
should we clarify?
Should we bring back Nest? No, you don't want to bring back anything until you got this committee evaluating the alternatives. You ought to consider the Nest thing, but the other one I put in your hopper is I went to this weirdo meeting. I've gotten invitations for the last year or longer, and it's called the EV Coordinator. Okay.
I'm talking about the low carbon fuel standards.
Talking about low carbon fuel standards, and you've got this very diverse set of interests in the room, and some of them are from the Air District, right? Some of them are from the Tesla charger guys there, ChargePoint charger. Woman is there, and car companies are there, and everybody who's trying to electrify transportation. Very diverse, very interesting group. Huge. I mean, we've got 50 people in the room and another 30 on the phone or something, right? So, like, they had these
for several years.
Yeah. It was last week. So I went for the first time because I had a reason to be in the city. I do mean San Francisco, not San Jose. I had a reason to be in the city in the evening, and then I had the Air District in the morning, so I just stayed. It wasn't the same. So it was like, wow, there are a lot of really cool program ideas that these folks all have, and they know about, and they understand the economics. And it's like, I think it would be cool if this committee, right, had some representation there, showed up, or otherwise there was a cross-pollination of ideas. Well, one of the things I talked to the Tesla person about and the ChargePoint person about, could we do some co-branding on your chargers and get our name and logo and 100% carbon, whatever the hell we are, you know, on a wrap or on your signage or something like that? That's an idea I brought up
a number of times. I told you I talked with ChargePoint about doing the same.
So it's like, I think there could be really things that shouldn't have to cost us very much. I mean, they may want to. They're cozying up to cities and public places, right?
Yeah, which
they are.
Which they are. And it's a little competitive. It's like, you know, we may be able to do this without a lot of cost. So I don't know.
They have a whole factory, manufacturing plant in Campbell.
What? They didn't choose my city?
Nope.
Okay, so I'm just trying to bring the table. I think, you know, I hope this council, right, that it gets pitched on all of these things which would, like, sort of expand their horizon. Because, I mean, and particularly transportation, it's the single biggest thing that we don't control. It is hard to get water heaters switched out. Why? Because actually electric costs more, right? The capital is harder, and then the ongoing costs of electric aren't there yet. Gas is cheap. But cars, transportation, is a big opportunity. 42% of our greenhouse gases.
I think we should just donate some electric buses to VTA in exchange for our name being on the outside of all the buses.
Whatever, right?
That's $1 million.
But I have another question. So, the cutoff, so that's an opinion, for what it's worth.
Okay.
We have this cutoff date of 11/17
to today.
For applications.
Okay.
And then Andrea will provide your city applicants to you to choose. By
I honestly haven't seen any promotion of this opportunity by my city.
Nor have I.
And I'm wondering, are we auditing what these cities are doing and actually doing the outreach? I don't want to be stuck with, you know, some, okay, I don't want to say Luddite, but somebody who's just doing it political reasons, or, you know, somebody that's not really.
So we did purchase ads in all community papers. That is going out this week, so this Friday you will see ads. We are promoting it, and I will follow up. I know most of the cities, I have seen them post the opportunity in their newsletters and on Nextdoor, but I will follow up.
Nextdoor was the only thing I saw.
Yeah, so I will follow up.
I've been saying it at every council meeting, but still that's a limited.
So out of curiosity, which six agencies do you have applications for?
We have one for Campbell, two for Los Gatos, two for Monte Sereno, three for Mountain View, one from the unincorporated county, Stanford specifically, and Sunnyvale has four applications.
Must be my saying it at the council meeting.
Not
well, you got one too.
I got one too.
So not from,
which shouldn't be. Okay, it's like I know I have people. That
I've got two. I can take yours.
We also have, you know, we do have 10 more days. I know, you know, I've received a lot of inquiries.
Just, some people, just that they wait to the last minute.
Yeah, I have received a lot of inquiries though beyond that, and with questions, and I'm assuming in the 11th hour they might roll in, but I don't want to assume that. I want to continue to push it out.
I'm intending to help in my city.
Great.
And I saw all the stuff online, so thank you. You just print it out, fill it out. You know, it's not a Word form or anything.
It's a PDF, a PDF form so that you can, yeah.
You can, okay.
You can fill it out, yeah.
We just have to step this up, right? Now, by the rules under which we adopted this, if I see somebody who I think would be really outstanding from, God forbid, Morgan Hill, Gilroy, that I happen to have some acquaintance with, or Campbell, and you haven't picked them, do I have the option of doing that, or no?
We said no. I think we said each city.
It's got to be my own city, right?
I thought you can, but
you
give up yours. Is that?
I don't think it was formalized as part of the motion that you can give your spot to another
city,
but the CEO does still have the three at-large.
Yeah. Okay, but let's say we end up with, we do better, we get 9 out of 12 agencies with submittals. What happens to the three?
They go to the, we said that it goes to the executive.
You also do.
Yeah.
So I could have my way with you, maybe.
Yeah.
Unbribable.
Unbribable. That's right.
That's not good.
All right. But I'd be lobbying you and your decision. Says I probably ought to get busy and help you, right?
And encourage them to apply
in
their cities. You know, let's say it's from Gilroy.
Because we have
yes,
the whole pool
sure,
to pick
yeah.
from.
And, you know, yeah, I mean, actually, my interest, right, is to make sure we have a great committee, so therefore I'm interested in having, I care as much about your city as mine. So. just by having probably the more people in my city.
Sure.
And forgive me, we have the three extras. One of those will have to go to Milpitas, I think you said that.
No, we may have to add Milpitas as another as the
And you
joined.
Get a 16
group. That's fine.
Or,
so
yeah, and
I would just clarify that when you bring this back.
Director Cortese also mentioned that he could appoint a Milpitas applicant to represent
that
county
right.
position.
He did.
That's
correct.
Correct.
That's right.
But
yeah,
yeah,
you do have an unincorporated applicant, right?
We do.
And Milpitas won't know right away to do it.
Tonight
so they're lag behind.
Tonight is the meeting.
Okay, well, we've all done our best.
Yeah.
So.
Right.
Yeah, I think I'll go ahead and expand the
Brian.
Second bullet, make a fourth bullet that is specific to community engagement as a priority.
Really?
Well, branding is the right phrase, I think, and uptake. I thought those were good phrasing.
Can we pitch your budget ideas? The staff reports?
Yeah, I would think if people are inclined to support the approach. It's a good question.
Okay.
Shall we move on to item number 4 then?
Sure.
As I open and close the public testimony, I see none coming forward.
This one's better. Okay, so this is. Oh, sorry. Started to jump in. Okay, sorry. So this is a returning another item that was discussed as we were also discussing this short-term temporary customer program advisory group that had the specific goals around programs, get us going quickly on programs. There was interest.
So, sorry. So this confused me, to be honest. So did I miss it? Is there an item 4 in the staff report information?
There is no staff report. This is just a presentation and a discussion.
Okay. I got confused that this was your discussion of the preceding item.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so you should have this as an item, and you can say staff report is presentation or whatever.
Okay.
But I'm sitting here going, that says that, and this says this.
Isn't this item 4?
This is item 4.
Yeah.
No, that's item 3.
We have the program advisory group.
Yes.
Right, and then number 4 is the long term.
That's what we just finished.
Yes.
And now we're talking about the long term.
Number.
So that's item 4 on this agenda. Because I think
so
we revised the agenda, though.
Yeah, but those were.
So
those
here
are
I have staff item number 3, customer advisory group, which is the discussion we just finished.
Right.
This is item number 4.
Yes.
And there's nothing in here. It goes right to item 5.
Yeah, because we did not provide a staff report on this.
Yeah,
So when I got this material, I thought it was applying to this item.
Okay.
In the future, we can just create a staff report and say presentation will be provided.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. Because they happen to be on top of each other.
Okay.
Yes, it
can
be a little confusing.
Yeah, and they are related discussions. So, when we presented the recommendation to have this temporary group to be able to quickly move along with programs. There was discussion among the board of we should have a longer-term customer advisory committee to do ? So we just wanted to bring back this part of the initial discussion around what the other CCEs are doing to help maybe frame and bring back this item for the board to consider what a longer-term group could look like. Just really quickly, don't need to go item by item, but this is just the other Bay Area CCEs and what their groups look like. For the most part, Sonoma Clean Power, Peninsula Clean Energy, East Bay Community Energy all have long-term customer oversight committees that have members that apply to serve, are selected by the board, and serve for 4-year terms and staggered terms. And various requirements on, you know, how they're represented and the different industries they represent, from more technical to you just have to live here, to including labor and unions and advocacy groups with East Bay. MCE is the one that really differs the most from these other models, which they just have a voluntary group of community organizers and stakeholders. They don't represent themselves individually. They represent the broader organizations within their very broad service area, and they host a monthly webinar to provide updates on what they do. And so the purpose of these groups, this is where they also have differences. So again, like I just mentioned with MCE, it's really providing input on what MCE is doing, also get input to MCE staff on what those communities' priorities are. Sonoma Clean Power, this is where it's, they're a very technical advisory group with ratepayer advocates and other folks that have been in the industry for a long time helping to review their budget and also provide input on programs. They also review contracts. Peninsula Clean Energy, they have a really fairly broad set of items in their charter that range from, giving direction on policy, doing advocacy and legislative advocacy, being community liaisons, so asking them to go out and table in their communities, and also discussing and providing their input on their future programs. And East Bay Community Energy is a little more similar to Sonoma Clean Power in that maybe they're not the most technical folks because the membership really is advocacy-based. But they are reviewing a lot of the initial operating policies because, as you know, they're not up and running yet. So they're really looking at a lot of their recommendations from the community going from the ground up. And the new kid on the block is San Jose Clean Energy. They are actually the deadline to apply for their Clean Energy Community Advisory Commission is this Friday. So they are before being operational, recruiting for this group now, and it serves, it's set up in a similar fashion to these to the other ones that have, 2 to 4 year terms for their members, a long-standing commission, and as you can see here, about two-thirds of their members, they are looking for some kind of expertise in all the different fields that are related to the work that a CCE would be doing, from outreach to advocacy. And their programs, and then they have 3 at-large members that the mayor will appoint. And for their purpose, it's most similar to Peninsula Clean Energy, where they are doing some input on the development of the agency, but really touching upon programs and doing some advocacy work and community engagement and outreach. So, again, this is sort of the different ways that we've looked at how the other CCEs have advisory groups and the level of input that they provide to their board of directors. So really just soft outbound outreach, get information what we're doing, put that out in the community. We have this, this was sort of where we ended up landing with our customer program advisory group, where it's an informal group, in the sense that it's temporary and has a very specific purpose and serves for a limited time. Option 3, this is similar to what PCE has and what San Jose's been forming, in that they are providing some technical input on some of the operations and procedures, but really looking at recommendations to the board on the program decisions and the like. And then option 4 is closest to Sonoma Clean Power's level of input in the decision making that their customer advisory committee has. So that's just all of them together.
So, but even in option 4, the board retains decision making authority per se, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, none that we've seen, they actually, vote on any decisions. It's
there's
really.
No, in other words, there's no authority to actually implement things.
Right. They're not bound
to a non-elected body.
No, it's more that they would, they're like internally reviewing things and then giving it to the board. And in a lot of cases, if staff isn't able to get things through the customer advisory groups, then that never makes it to the board, right? There's
so it's a little different. I mean, actually, in cities, right, most of us have planning commissions. Council appoints planning commissioners, but then they actually have authority to make land use decisions to a certain point. When the project gets big enough, it goes above the line. If somebody's really dissatisfied, they can appeal to council, but for most of what happens in my city, planning commission is as busy as the council because they're there's a lot of smaller stuff, right? But very often they're the final authority for ministerial and judicial decisions. Just deciding on project.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess you're not in your option. I mean, that would for me that would be an option five, and I'm not really advocating for that. But that's real decision making. The
four
is
the most stringent where the committee has a lot of authority, not necessarily deciding anything, but almost.
What's the distinction between three and four?
Four is a layer of everything, like reviewing contracts, reviewing policy, reviewing things before it makes it to the board.
You want citizens reviewing our power contracts?
Power contract, or I guess
that's what they're talking about,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, that's what, and that is
done
what
privately
everything,
just like our risk committee does.
No, their public Brown Act meetings that. I mean, I don't know really the details.
Who's using this model for what?
Sonoma
contract?
Clean Power.
Reviews
any contract.
Meeting?
Any contract over $100,000 is reviewed by this by their group.
Right. It has to get the approval of this group before it goes.
So I guess my question about that model is how do they protect their negotiating position?
They may have a level of approval before negotiation happens, like certain requirements before the actual, pricing or.
So, and their membership as well is all very technical folks who've come from the CPUC, and their experience is really in that space.
Or whatever.
So the
genesis of putting this topic on today was. I believe at the October 11th meeting, correct me if I'm wrong, Pam, but Director Miller brought up what's the longer-term vision of this advocacy group,
mm-hmm.
And so we threw it on here today to kind of get some feedback from you folks. Internally, our recommendation is to see how it goes with the CPAG and then come back to what that longer-term vision might be, but I certainly want to hear from you.
I think that I found the information useful and informative. Thanks. Got a little confused with the San Jose being its own couple of pages. So
it's new.
That'll help balance it out because it almost came out like a recommendation kind of thing. So that was a little confused on that. So I think it's good to give this feedback. And if you do it as just an information follow-up,
mm-hmm.
because when we have a new CEO, there may be some input from that person that we want to hear from.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is a great place to kind of say, here's where things are at, okay? And we'll update it, but include the recommendation that we set it aside for a little bit of time to see how the other group is working, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And you might want to do a couple of things, like saying, what's the mixture, business, residential, whatever?
Mm-hmm.
What is the appointment for 2 years term, 4 years term, staggered terms? What is the authority, power, what is the staff requirement? These are questions that as we go through and move through the discussions, we can pinpoint the discussion. Should it be an appointed? Should it be terms? Should it be Brown Acted? Should it be? These are the kind of questions that when you look at this nice summary, that summary engenders these types of questions.
So my first question from going back and listening to the discussions the board was having in meetings was, why do we want a longer-term customer advisory committee? So my goal question mark was, there was a suggestion by one of the directors that perhaps a subcommittee of the board needs to come together and take some time and think about what purpose would this group serve? So going back to the different, ways that they provide input and oversight, why, because right now it was very much programs, right? So that's, we kind of built something that could be quick and speedy about programs, but what kind of oversight or advisory functions would the board like to see with a customer advisor?
I don't think we were united in our, in
right.
our vision at all, so I can't even tell you what it really is.
So that's why we're kind of, I was kind of recommending that maybe...
If form follows function, what function do we want?
So,
and we can't have a form until we understand.
Well, I think it comes back to what the CEO wants to do, and I think the CEO could work with the executive board. I wouldn't necessarily want to set up yet another subcommittee.
So we received, staff received direction at the last meeting to come back at the November meeting with this item.
Yep.
So would we just want to see if we would still want to come back with the same presentation with your improvements added and just kind of keep the conversation going? And
I think you just honor the board's intention that you come back, but I couldn't agree more. It's like you got to see how this first thing plays out. We'll be busy with that anyway. when we finally do a permanent thing, I think we ought to consider whether we have any CNI in there or if it's just residential.
I think
and,
it's...
And what else about it? I think it's a similar good point.
Well, it's important to show that it's on our we're going to do it, right? There's some people that they may not need it done now, but they want to make sure that it is going to happen.
I
so
that was consistent.
So bringing it back does that. And okay, so we move on to the next item. Power procurement.
To your comment about San Jose, why would you feature San Jose with two slides? I mean, they're not even double yet.
I will
put them in the table. It was honestly a formatting challenge, and so I will make the improvement.
Well, or leave them out because they're not even done yet. And just say, well, you know, San Jose is going to do something like this.
Okay.
I sure wouldn't. Yes, it is a bit confusing. It's like, oh, are we planning a merger? That's like,
okay. Sorry. I didn't go that far.
This is formatting.
It was a formatting challenge, so okay.
Like, we should do this because, no, it's like, no.
It's the unagendized discussion.
Apologies for my confusing presentation.
Okay. What she said.
And then we'll add a recommendation to defer until later. All right, this last item, I wanted to throw this out there for today. We met a month ago at the workshop. We had a lot of data thrown at folks. It was a really good discussion. I didn't want to just sit for another month or two without some sort of a follow-up from that workshop. Talking internally, we felt like maybe the next step out of that workshop is to get some feedback or a consensus on what those benchmarks for 2019, we're set for 17 and 18, but do we want to develop a benchmark for what our renewables should be as part of the portfolio? Just as a reminder, we threw out three options last time, which was minimum RPS, the rest was large hydro, which was a good option from a finance viewpoint, but not so good as far as percentage. We could just maintain the course, or lastly, we could have 50% PCC1, the rest large hydro, which would be the most expensive option. So having said that, those were just options based on, or just three options, but we can go a lot of different directions. So this staff report just talks about getting a consensus on what direction we want to go as far as maybe setting a benchmark for RPS procurement. So option one I threw out there was, do we want to not just meet the minimum, but set a benchmark to be 2% or always 5% higher than the minimum? Just to give you an example, if the minimum is 33, we say we want to be always be 2% above that next year. If it's 35, it's 37, so on. Rule of thumb for this option, though, would be on average, including the Lapidus load that anticipates going to get voted on tonight, would be for every percentage above the minimum,
it's about 700,000. Okay, so just something to keep in mind as we make that decision. But this option would be really good as far as long-term planning for procurement as well, because then we'll have a pretty good certainty of where we need to land. Option two, not a lot of certainty here, but I heard a lot at the workshop regarding we have to be better than PG&E. Do we want to set a benchmark to always be better than PG&E? The problem there is not a lot of certainty. Also, PG&E's percentages are changing because their load is going away, and then they retire the dirtier power. And so without even doing nothing, the percentages are going to get better. But that's a second option. And then the third option is we set our own benchmark. Currently, we're at 50%. There is a risk. We talked about that at the workshop. But we internally decide this is what our benchmark is going to be. So we can follow the RPS requirement. We can follow PG&E or follow our own. I don't have a recommendation today. It's one of those things. Let's have a discussion about it. See where you folks feel stronger about it. Said that, please.
So one comment is, where does the state mandate fit into this?
So this,
the RPS.
That's the RPS.
That's the RPS.
That is the RPS.
Yes. So the next
RPS stands for?
A renewable portfolio standard.
Okay, and that's tied to the state.
That's the state mandate.
Okay, so I would just be sure to define it that way.
Absolutely.
And then PG&E is going to go above or below the state. It's going to at least meet the state. So PG&E is going to...
They're actually probably ahead of schedule.
From all we've been reading, yes. Mm-hmm. So it would, PG&E would already be exceeding what's here?
Most likely, yes.
So for all intents and purposes, this is a no?
That's just our minimum.
Okay, so I think that needs to be clear.
Okay.
That this is the state requirement. But PG&E is also above this now.
Right.
It might be nice to have a little overlay diagram that says where PG&E is and likely to be. Okay, and then if you go to the second one, you have a comment on the first one that it would cost us 0.07 million per 1% below. Do we have any comparable for options 2 and 3? I kind of hate to have.
The real question is, does it have to be PCC1? Do we have some other option?
And that's what we talked about. I don't know if we have any new data on that, but that's one of the risks that we have, is we may end up where we can't use PCC2 in 2019 and beyond. Right?
Because of the forming and shaping carbon that it adds.
Based on the AB, yeah.
Say that again, please.
Could be, that's one of the things we talked about in the workshop, where regulations may be out there with AB 1110 that we couldn't use PCC2, or we shouldn't be using PCC2.
Because?
AB 1110 is introducing GHG emissions intensity to the power content label,
right,
starting in 2020.
Right.
And the current staff proposal for how that emissions intensity would be calculated, which previously there was no statewide standardized methodology calculating this because it hadn't been reported, but the preliminary proposal they put forth would attach some emissions to PCC2 RECs, even if they're coming from zero carbon sources like wind and solar. And it has to do with, as Rob mentioned, the contract structure of out-of-state resources often includes some fossil for what they call firming and shaping, which is basically to ensure that you have a known quantity of electricity crossing the border at any one time.
Okay. All right. I mean, I'm starting to connect that now. I remember the discussion. I wasn't making the connection. Thank you for the question, Rob.
I think maybe we want, in the board staff report, a reminder detail of this, you know, why you're only using PCC1, and it's more than, it's even worse than just only using PCC1. We're saying we don't want, maybe we're saying we don't want geothermal, and Howard doesn't want biomass, right? So we've gone even beyond the expense of just getting PCC1. We've even limited it down from there. I think we need to, it's complicated. So I we're going to probably get into that discussion at the board meeting. You know, why does it have to be this PCC1? Why does it have to be so expensive? I mean, you basically, with this, cornered us into saying we have to give up on the 50% renewable because we can't afford it. when there are the other options of we're saying we are willing to take it on our, maybe we're willing to take it on our report card, buying out of state power, right? I mean, that should be an option that's explained that we could go that way.
It's really, really important, Rob, that you're, if there's a way to present it with, I'm going to call it the assumptions.
Yes, sure.
Okay, the assumption is know this, know that, and it forces this. But if we revisit the assumptions,
you could almost make a tree out of it. If you decided to change this assumption and allow out of state, now we can go this way. Because I'm not sure the assumptions made here are set by the board. That's why I'm.
But I don't
want to
confuse the issue, but BCC1 could face exactly the same thing as BCC as far as equipment and shipping, because it's a connected solar in California, connected to the grid, does not mean that it does not require a backup. It's just today's explanation is that way. So I think our narrative could be continue to be carbon free from our resources, but again, that's for another discussion.
Well, that gets back to the assumption that are we willing to take out of state power? Are we willing to take geothermal kind of, or maybe not willing to take biomass? So that seems to be the worst one of it.
So I mean, so I think some kind of tree, some kind of understanding of assumptions would be really beneficial. And even if you just put as a backup, not necessarily explain a couple of these things that you just explained, would be helpful for the board. And each one of the descriptions should have the same type of information about the cost. So like the last one, option three, the risk of maintaining current strategy is that you can only fill open with PC1 incremental blah, blah, blah cost. But I don't think you had a cost number two.
I don't.
Okay. So even if you can't put a cost in there.
Yeah. It's a little speculative right now.
Or put a range or state it. It's speculative. Make sure the information is consistent in each one. And then, okay, there was something in the whole thing that got me confused. Got two separate points. One is that option three has a statement in here that says our current strategy of 50% renewable and 50% carbon free. Okay.
That's what we are currently.
Right.
And this logic line is pushing us away from
so
that.
So I thought we've been saying we were 100. I know we don't want to use 100%, but 100% carbon free.
We are. The renewable is carbon free. So
remember, this was one of my big questions on the web page with the circle. It isn't our current strategy. So we're more than 50% carbon. We're 100% carbon free, recognizing the nuance. So if you just say 50% renewable and 50% carbon free, that's not accurate.
That's confusing. I agree. I was thinking of hydro at the time.
So that needs to be clear.
We'll get that.
And the same thing, I think, is with we do the tree, the yes-nos, that same kind of statement should be in each one of these. It says this is the one that puts that 100% at risk. And then the backup, which is the presentation we had at the last meeting, which was really excellent as well, was the whole explaining 1,600 pounds of carbon per kilowatt, whatever, right? My neighbor, 14, and ours went down to 14.
Yeah.
Okay. That piece of paper alone was worth its
weight.
Yeah,
the three bar chart,
that was
or four bars chart,
brilliant.
Was a very good point.
And the whole board would be benefit from that.
Or even be reminded. They saw it once already.
Yeah. So I think that's a critical portion of this discussion.
Let me just throw this out there. Do you feel from the workshop this is probably the next step, is kind of deciding or getting some direction on this, or do you, is it a different?
I think it's really right on target.
Okay.
Because I, and I know at least one other director is really worried about the future. So I think that this is extremely appropriate.
So a couple thoughts. Maybe the first one is, I think the board is slowly getting used to the idea that, I mean, they're going to evolve, I think, from this, we have to be 100% carbon free, to whatever the new messaging is. I see them slowly, the ones that were, had the most problem with it are slowly moving, I think. So what I'm trying to say is, don't assume that that's the way we're going to go yet. Right, it's going to take a long time for those that had really held on to that to change their mind. But I think that they are starting to, even Howard's starting to say carbon neutral, and Jim was quiet last time we talked about it. Right, so I feel like the answer isn't necessarily do anything you can to say we're 100% carbon free, that we may be able to move somewhere else. And then, so my second point is, and there may be more, but I see two paths that are really the comparison, which you don't show here. One is this path here that says we can't be 100% renewable. The other one says we can't keep our 50% renewable because we're trying to be as carbon free technically as possible. The other one is we're a little less carbon free technically, but we can keep our 100% renewable. So then it to me it comes down to a question is, what is better? To have that extra 15% to 20% renewable in our portfolio, but be not as clean in our carbon free, or to be as clean as possible but not have the renewable. I think it's better to have more renewable and not using up the hydro resource. Many of you weren't here early on last year when we had the discussion about using the hydro, and now that what's his name is not on our board anymore, we haven't talked about it. Somidian, yeah.
So
I guess what I'm saying is I hesitate to just fill in with all hydro.
I would agree with that too, but I think the other main aspect is, can we afford, what can we afford?
Well, that's why I'm saying, it says you can't afford to be the 50% renewable if you take this, you must buy PCC1. So that's why I still think it should be on the table that out-of-state renewable is an option for us to consider.
Well, shouldn't what we're discussing now be part of the discussion we had on item number 3 to whatever night it was on what your outlook and contracts are? Does this have a direct bearing on that?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
Your first presentation on
the RSO?
Oh, yes.
Because one of your options is out-of-state wind.
Well,
which will have the firming and shaping.
No, actually that project, it is out-of-state, but it has a direct dynamic transmission capacity, so it would qualify as bucket one. We're not buying anything other than bucket one as part of the
RSO. So in this presentation, it would be good to say, oh, by the way, remember that, it does this.
I'm not sure I would tie those together. That's going to get confusing.
Well, be prepared to answer the question because I may ask it.
I didn't make it completely clear, but maybe
yes,
you
could
figure out
idea.
A way to present
I'll
it clearer to the board.
Okay.
So Rod's gone quiet over there.
Did
he agree with everything?
That's BCC what?
You know, I haven't gotten my knickers in a twist about this to the same extent as my colleagues. There's a way to nuance the message. I still think that's the case.
Well, and that's what I'm agreeing. Nuanced message and keeping 50% renewable may be a better solution for the board than
so,
this other one.
And I respect, I think I said this before, I respect the Palo Alto message to 100% carbon neutral, right? And yes, euphemistically it's called carbon free, and if that's not technically correct and it's not good enough, then I think over time maybe that's... But I do think
mind, right, if we got to really quantify what, if we're going to maintain the purest message with the purest board members, if we're feeling terribly guilty about this, then I think we damn well better have better understand cost consequences.
Yeah, the cost. The
not
cost
just
needs
today,
to
but on an ongoing basis. Yeah. It seems to me like you're, you know, if you're tying your hands in one dimension, right? You know, PG&E isn't, and people that the other agencies we're competing for power with don't. And so, yeah, I don't. I certainly don't feel like we can't change and evolve our messaging over time. It's okay. And I think particularly if you're straightforward, you're upfront, and you, you know, you have a page that talks about all of the. How do we talk about carbon and what does carbon free mean to us?
Well, this is all tying into the branding, I think. I mean, really is.
Well, the branding
it's
of
what
is
it
one
we
thing,
are
and
doing.
Policy about energy is another, but I think.
But it, branding
certainly
will help the policy if it evolves,
yeah,
connect.
Yes. We're a startup. Realizing that the whole market is shifting so dramatically, I'm not up for getting too rigid about much of anything. Right? We're going to have to think on our feet. I don't want the staff to go to retarded knots to buy products that are. It's kind of like, okay, I frankly don't do this. I know that colleges and universities have, right? They work very hard to make sure that they divested of, say, fossil fuels, right? They have to go buy these products, financial products that come with a much higher overhead than, say, the S&P 500 ETF. So they're paying. So there are strategies for doing it if you're big enough, but there's some overhead costs.
It's unintended consequences.
And it all sounds good, and then you start looking at the overhead of. I'm likening this to something quite completely different, and I don't know what applies, but I just. Sure, the board is really aware of it, has big numbers up in front of it, appropriate numbers up in front of it when it makes some decision to kind of deviate in our purchasing program. That's all.
So I think we've wound down on number five.
Got some great feedback when we put them together.
Okay.
We'll be ready for three.
Any other comments, staff remarks?
Alan mentioned a vote tonight from Lapidus, and we've got the data to PEA, so we should have the pro forma updated for the November 29th meeting as well.
I just planned my
plane
flight, so I would be here for it. Cost me 20,000 air miles.
Oh, no.
20,000 air miles, okay. These days, that's not worth that much.
That's $20.
I was on top of the 50 I already spent.
So, update from the hiring committee. We have a decision. We are negotiating contract, and we'll have a recommendation for closed session next board meeting.
And I think it's fair to say that we were really not only impressed with staff feedback, because we had a subset of staff we talked to, but you know, your thinking was very helpful. Those of you who participated, I'm grateful for that.
I speak for all of us that we appreciated the opportunity to.
I think we brought in the last candidate because after the first three candidates, what you telegraphed as your first and last choice is kind of not ours. So we were looking for maybe more of somebody that covered both better. I mean, the first one, it helped us understand what you wanted, and we thought this last candidate we brought in for the extra interview would work for both of us better than the other set of candidates, because I think our first choice may have been your last choice on the first set of candidates. So.
Well, we appreciate the time and effort you put into it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you're putting a huge amount of time to this.
used to it. All right, anything else? I guess we're adjourned.